two of our Air National Guard bases in Newburgh and West Hampton due to the use of firefighting foam containing chemical. Presence of these chemicals has contaminated drinking water sources and resulted in the listing of Hoosic Falls to the federal Superfund site by the EPA. Have there been any instances of PFCs migrating from groundwater to surface waters that are jurisdictional under the Clean Water Act?
The one example where I believe that has occurred is in Cape Fear, where a facility that I believe was operated by Chemours, as far as that company, they had releases of PFOA-PFS into groundwater. And those chemicals also were released into surface water, but also the groundwater migrated some discharge into the surface water. There is also now a new chemical that's also followed that exact same path with JS. Which unfortunately was designed to replace the PFCs. Unfortunately, that is now also discharging the ground surface.
What's the impact of PFC contamination to those jurisdictional waters?
Obviously, in that particular example, the concern is that the intake for the city of Wilmington is directly down gradient of those discharges. So the city of Wilmington has had to face challenges in meeting its water demands for its customers because of the impact of its water supply from those chemicals.
How difficult is it to clean up PFC contamination once it reaches a river or a lake, and what can be done to prevent further contamination?
Obviously, the cleanup once it's in the surface water can be very expensive. You're now dealing with very large volumes of water that have to be treated down to very, very low levels. We're talking about levels in the very low parts per trillion. So minute levels have to be removed from the water. Clearly, the most effective way to achieve long-term treatment is actually to remove the source. To physically clean up the source and clean up the plume in addition to treating the surface water. Because otherwise you'd be treating the surface water essentially in perpetuity.
Mr. Holland, as you noted in your testimony, the Clean Water Act provides an important tool for citizens to compel polluters to clean up environmental degradation when environmental authorities fail to take action. If pollution that migrates from a point source to rivers and lakes through groundwater is not covered under the Clean Water Act, what impact will that have on communities that are living with this toxic contamination?
Well, it'll be devastating to them because they won't have an effective way to stop it. Or, and just been talking here about local governments, I can tell you in the case that we worked on the local government support. And the Fourth Circuit case, an amicus brief, was filed by the county managers in South Carolina. And I can tell you that's about as conservative as a Republican county council could ever find. There's no question that they thought their community needed to be protected. And in our Tennessee case, the state agency in Tennessee even is supporting our position on amicus brief as well, as is the county of Claremont, Ohio. Because local communities that are close to their citizens know that the citizens don't have the power to enforce the law. You can't always count on Washington or the state capital to protect you.
And also the issue of resources, because how aggressive have states historically been in addressing this type of contamination absent intervention by the EPA or citizen action under the Clean Water Act?
Well, here's the problem. Some of these polluters, for example, I'm working on Duke Energy, is one of the richest institutions on planet Earth. Our state agency in North Carolina simply does not have the legal horsepower to fight, and we are handling one case, and not only does Duke Energy have the largest law firm in North Carolina working on it, they've just added 8 to 10 new lawyers from LA and DC to come down to Roxboro, North Carolina to fight us over pollution from a coal ash. And the state agencies, amongst other things, know